عايز تمشي براحتك عايز تمشي براحتك
So we are already done inshallah with the functionality of the data in control layer, which has to do with frame, the functionality that defines the start and the end of the packet. We have taken several examples on the two most common approaches, either a flag based or a count slash length based approach, and these are the general categories of all packetization
methodologies. Now we will move to the second functionality. So who remembers what was the second functionality of the data link control?
Error detection and correction.
Okay, so yes, because we said that the data link control is responsible for reliable end-to-end or point-to-point delivery, sorry, point-to-point delivery of data packets, right? So the framing came from the fact that packets were actually defined at they started being defined at the level of data link. So it was the responsibility of the data link to form the packet, right? And this is why the framing functionality is the responsibility of the data link. The second thing is reliable communication. So reliable communication means that you have to minimize the errors, okay? Can we eliminate the errors?
It's hard.
Hard or impossible?
Yeah,
can you, in a practical system, can you eliminate errors? So you have a total error-free system? Why?
Because you can't do it if like, you increase the power of something, but it will be impractical.
Yeah, so increase the power to wait.
So you're saying
that. So you increase the power until what value?
If we take power to noise ratio, it's until infinity.
So yeah, so basically you need infinite power.
Yes.
Or the other option is, if I cannot afford infinite power, the other option is?
Zero
noise. Infinite time, right? So basically, I have to have, in order to reach zero error, I have to somehow be able, like zero guaranteed zero error, I have to have to somehow have infinite resources, right? And this cannot happen practically, okay? I either need to wait for an infinite time, or I need to increase my transmission power to an infinite value, right? So this means that I'm consuming infinite resources. So we cannot really eliminate the bit error rate or the array, the error, sorry, in communication, okay? Now the question comes, okay, so that's the first part. The second part of the question is, I didn't talk about this slide yet, I'm just introducing a new part, okay? The second part is, okay, we actually did error control at the physical layer, right? And you learned about some techniques for error control at the physical layer, okay? Now, I mean, why are we doing it again at the data link control layer?
Because not all errors get fixed in the physical layer.
Okay.
So, what remains should be fixed within the layers.
I mean, why? Why should, am I going to do better than the physical layer?
In the above layers, not the physical. The physical layer deals with bits, but in the upper layers, we deal with packets. So if the error doesn't happen, doesn't have to be in bits only. Sometimes the error happens in the packets itself.
Okay.
So for example, if one packet we received half of it, so the bits have been received, but the packet is not received.
Yeah. So to summarize this, when I go to upper layer, I start looking at packets. And as we have seen before, the packet error probability is much higher than the bit error probability. Why?
Because you only need one packet, one bit.
Exactly. So any single bit in the packet that comes into error will cause the whole packet to be in error. That's one reason. The other reason is what you see in this slide, that you can actually have some framing errors that causes packet errors, but there are no bit errors. So you lose synchronization, for example, for one reason or the other. You cannot detect the start of the frame. Then what will happen is bits, as seen by the physical layer, are still all received correctly. But then when you go to the packet and you try to detect whether the data within a particular packet, you might actually have shifted one way or the other, and you are detecting, reading the packet incorrectly, and then accordingly what will happen? You will have errors again, right? So these two reasons together combined means that as we go to this upper layer, this data link layer, we still need to do
another level of error control. Okay? Now, before going into how error control happens, you can see from this slide some possibilities of framing errors, right? And we have already discussed most of these implicitly, either through some of your questions or through what I mentioned in the lecture, what kind of framing errors that can happen, right? So you can maybe, framing errors can happen mainly because of two major sources, either loss of synchronization, so you cannot really detect the pattern correctly for one reason or the other, or you shift in detecting the bits, or the other reason is the actual bits, they get into error, right? And then, looking at the different framing techniques, we found that some of them are more sensitive to synchronization, some others are less sensitive to synchronization, but they are more sensitive to bit errors and so on. So we have discussed this before, and this summarizes more or less what we have discussed. So there is not much new information in the previous slide. What's more, towards what we are talking about today is this slide. So far, you are convinced of two things, right? That number one, we still need error detection, right? And correction at the level of the data link. So the physical layer is not sufficient. And the other thing is?
We cannot have error-free system.
Yeah, we cannot have error-free transmission even after doing this second level of error control. And even if you do a more error control at upper layers, you still will suffer from some kind of errors or the other, but you are trying to minimize this until you reach a certain desired service or quality of service, okay? Now, in terms of error detection and correction, we will divide this into two parts. We will start by the error detection techniques that are used at the DLC, okay? And then we will move into the error correction. Now, some of these techniques that you see here are similar to the ones that are used in the channel coding, okay? But in channel coding, you have many more other techniques, okay? So in data link, we only have two techniques, the parity check and the cyclic redundancy, but in physical layer, we have actually many other techniques in addition to these ones, okay? Before going into the details of the techniques that are used, I want to discuss with you something that you might have came across already in your digital communication, but I want to recap on that, and if you haven't heard about it before, then you will hear about it right now. Why is it useful? Why is it that we say that when we add extra redundant bits to our data, right, we can actually prevent or protect this data against errors, or we have better capability of detecting errors that happen in this data?
Because adding redundant information, so this information is a function of version information.
Okay.
So when it conflicts with the version information, so we either have an error here or an error here.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, we know that we have it. Second of all, how it's done as the mathematical formula, we might have also a third source that generated it, and this will also help detect is the error in the original data or in the redundant
mm-hmm.
data.
Okay, so you are describing more or less, like in details, what happens when we add redundant bits, and what you are saying is correct. But I want kind of an abstraction, so I don't want to look into the details, okay? I want, like, from an abstract concept point of view, why is it that when I add more bits, redundant bits, to my information, okay? Why is this helpful? Why is this something that allows me to actually have better capability of detecting errors, okay, and in some cases correcting them. But for now, we are focusing on detecting. So just from an abstract point of view, why is this useful? Yes. So the functionality that you described is correct, but it's not the abstract look that I'm looking for. Yes.
Can say it's like a spare part, which is, for example, if you have an error at the beginning, you can play with the error, the extra error, the extra bit, which can take the same data or the same information and the bits that have some of the error. So you have something in spare. You can can hold, it can.
That's another way of saying what he said, because I am adding them as functions of the other bits. So basically, they are somehow related to them, so they enable me to discover errors. That's what you are trying to say with the spare concept that you are talking about. Correct, but it's not what I'm looking for, like from an abstract point of view.
It gives me advantage to control that. As I know, where it's beginning was.
That's not that simple.
It makes looking for the data more controllable.
Yani, you are touching on the concept, but you are not saying the concept. I'll take his and then take yours.
It describes the data. It gives me an indication of what I'm gonna receive.
No. Yani, you are saying close to what he said, but not what I'm looking for.
The better rate in our data will decrease, because, for example, if we have like 50% probability of having an error, and we have only 5 bits, so maybe 2.5 or 2 of them will have that. But if we add more bits, if we had like 10 bits, it will. So some of these extra bits might have the error instead of.
Not in that way, because okay, if I add bits but I still use them as information bits, I'm not gaining anything. I'll stop.
Just last thing.
No. Khalas, enough. Okay. So let me try to describe this by a simple example, and you will see the kind of abstraction that I'm looking for. And forgive me for using geometry. So I'm going to use a geometric description for the situation, okay? So basically, assume that I'm sending 2 bits. Okay, so assume that the pen doesn't work. So in this case, what do I have to do? So let's continue. So I have 2 bits, B1, B2, as information bits, right? What are the possible data combinations that I can have? So these are my actual data combinations, right? So what are the possible combinations? Right? Now, if I want to represent this geometrically in a two-dimensional plane, so what would I have? So this is B1. This is B2, right? Where are the points that I'm using? 0, 0, right?
Yes.
1, 0,
mm-hmm.
Correct?
Yes.
1, 1,
0.
And this one is 0, 1, correct? Okay? Now, if I go and do the simplest form of redundancy addition, and let's say in this case I decided to put 1 parity bit extra to these, and I'm going to use even parity. Okay? So what are the values of P for the different situations? So for this situation, for the first situation, 0, 0. I'm looking for even parity, so P is going to be 0 or 1?
Zero.
Zero.
Yeah.
So the idea of having even parity is that in addition to the information bits, with the parity bit, the total number of ones is even, right? So it must be here that it's zero. Okay? So for the case of 0, 1?
1.
For the case of 1, 0?
0.
1. For the case of 1, 1?
1,
0.
Zero.
Okay?
Zero.
So this is an even parity case, right? Hello?
The combination
would
be different.
Okay? 0, 0, 0. So these are the possible transmissions that are going to come from my transmitter, right? Now I have how many bits?
3.
In order to represent this geometrically, what do I need?
3-dimensional.
A cube, a 3-dimensional plane, right? So in this case, let's look at how our data would look like, right? So here is my 3-dimensional cube. Right? And let's keep these as B1, B2, and then this is the extra parity 1 added, right? Yes?
Why did you assume that B1 and B2 is orthogonal to each other?
Orthogonal to each other?
Yeah. Why?
Because they are 2 different bits. Yani, why did I assume they are orthogonal to each other?
واحد على
why do you assume that X and Y are orthogonal to each other? I mean, it's just a two-dimensional plane where one axis is spanning one bit, the other axis is spanning the other bit, right? So if I have, for example, a Cartesian vector, X, Y, tamam? I always assume that the first one is in the direction of X, the other one direction. So basically, I'm spanning the binary space with two bits. So the two bits are independent, so each one of them is gonna be right? Just a geometric representation, okay? So for the case of three bits, okay, this is the dimensions that I'm gonna span, B1, B2, and the P, right? Okay? Now, if I did not follow the parity, if I had all the possibilities, right? So if I just didn't say that this has to do even parity or anything, and I had three bits, P1, B1, B2, and P, what are the possible values? How many possible values I will have?
Eight
possible values, right? How do they look like in this space?
Cube.
The corners of the cube, right?
Yes.
So basically, these are the points that I would have had if I decided to span all the possible values, right? Correct? And they will be simply, these are all the possible values that I can get with the three bits. Correct, Shabab?
Yes.
And how many of these? Eight. Okay? Now, can I mark the ones that I used for this parity scheme?
Yes.
First of all, okay? Do you agree with me that this distance between any two points, between two any adjacent points, should be equal to this distance or not?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Because it's a one bit difference, right? So it should be the same thing, right? Okay. Now let's try to mark the ones that are used in this parity scheme. Where in this case, I didn't use the eight possible. I only used four out of the eight. And not any four. They were carefully selected. So let's see why they were carefully selected. 0, 0, 0. Which one is this?
Origin.
So this is one, right? Okay. 0, 1, 1. Where is this? So, 0 on the B1, and then 1 on the B2, and then 1 on the P, right? So, it's this guy. So, here. That's the second one. So, we did this, we did this. Third one.
1, 0, 1.
1, and then 0, so I will not move in the B2 direction, and then 1. So, it's this one, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, let's put this guy. That's the third one. Fourth one?
1, 1, 1, 1, 0. So
you're
not moving.
So 1, 1, and there is no movement in the P, right? So it's here. So that's the last one.
We increase the distance between.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So what did we do now? Right? Notice how these points were selected? None of them is adjacent to the other on the same edge, right? What's the gain of this? That all of them, the minimum distance between any two points in this shape, right? Any two valid points that I use for transmission, is greater than the minimum distance in this case, right? So it's as if I've managed to take my data points, the four data points, and make them further apart from each other, right? By spanning another dimension, okay? Okay, by adding that extra bit, I've spanned three dimensions instead of two, and then I took the furthest corners from each other, so I ended up with distance between the valid points, which are the red ones, right? That's greater than the distance between the original ones without a parity, okay? Why distance makes things better? Think of it this way, right? As a receiver, okay, think of it as if the receiver, when you see a degraded signal, it's similar to that to when you are looking from here to some writing on the other side of the wall, okay? And there is one factor, which is how strong is your eyesight, right? That's one factor. But assuming that all of us are like 6/6 sharp, okay? Now, the other factor is going to be, what's the resolution that you can make over there, right? So if you can make the letters bigger, so they are apart from each other, and the empty spaces inside the letters are apart from each other, it's easier for me here to read the word fire there. Mm-hmm. But it's not easier to read the word right underneath it from my place. Why? Because the other word is smaller, so the distance between the edges of the letters are very close. So further away from that point, I cannot resolve them, right? So my resolution is not good. But when I make them bigger, more apart, it's easier for me to resolve them. So I will not make mistake between valid points, except higher noise is affecting the system, right? So this means less probability, because noise, as we know, is a Gaussian distribution. So the probability of higher value is much less, right? Okay? I will take your question, just a minute, okay? So that's why coding in general, where does the advantage come from? It comes from spanning further dimensions without utilizing all the possibilities. Because if I said, okay, add one more bit, but use them to represent like data as well, right? So I will end up with 8 possibilities, the resolution did not enhance, right? I'm letting go, or I'm spending or trading efficiency, because I'm using an extra redundant bit, right? For the gain of reliability, right? Okay. Now again, as I mentioned earlier, even in digital communication, these have to be carefully designed, right? Imagine that I did all this, and then I ended up choosing my points to be here, right? So I must be joking, right? I mean, what did I gain by doing this, right? So you have to carefully select the pattern here, or design your code. This is called code design, such that the points are apart from each other, okay? As much as you can. So what if I add one more parity? So instead of P best, only P, I have P1 and P2. I'll end up with how many dimensions?
Four
dimensions. I still have how many valid?
Four
only, right? Even though I have 4 bits, which allows me up to 16, right? So it must be that in that case, I will be able to even keep them further apart from each other. It's going to be a distance in 4 dimensions, okay? So it's like a hypercube and all these things, okay? So now, 2 important notations to learn from this. These are called the valid code words for a particular code, okay? And typically, we don't say the word valid. So we just call them the code words of your code, okay? So even though you are using 3 bits for this code, but you are only having 4 code words, right? Okay, what if I have this B1, B2, B3, P1, P2, okay? How many code words should I have in this case?
8,
right? So the number of valid code words depends only on the number of information bits, right? So in this case, 8 code words. Okay? So that's an important thing. The second important thing is this distance, if you notice, it's measured in what dimension? What's the dimension of this? Can anyone think? I mean, when I say the distance is bigger, the distance is smaller, how do I measure this distance?
Energy.
Is it Euclidean distance?
Euclidean.
No, it's not. I mean, geometrically, I represented it as Euclidean, but it's not really Euclidean.
So
I'm dealing with binary bits, yes, Euclidean.
No.
I mean, if you deal with it from the energy point of view, and that's one approach for physical layer of coding, it's called trellis coded modulation, but that's a very specific type, then yes, you will deal with this as a Euclidean distance. But keep that on the side. Typically, you just deal with bits, okay? You see bits in front of you. So how are you going to measure this distance?
To the, you're considering the probability of the noise?
Like, we have an unit, which is the difference between each 2 bits, and we measure it with
How many differences? So basically, I will measure the distance between any 2 code words, right? Using how many bits are different between those 2 code words. Okay? Got the idea? There's something called Hamming distance. Okay? H-A-M-M-I-N-G. Okay? Distance. Okay? This Hamming distance is equal to the Hamming distance between any two code words, okay, is equal to the number of bits that are different between the two code words. For example, okay, if I have 10111000, okay, that's code word W1, and then I have another code word W2, which is 00110110111. Okay, what's the Hamming distance between those? What's the distance between those two code words? Okay, count how many bits are different between them. Okay, so if you do that, these are different, right? Plus, these are different, these are different, and these. So how many?
Four.
So the Hamming distance, H, sometimes they call it D, the Hamming distance, is equal to 4 between those two code words, okay? So it's the number of bits that are different. How can you mathematically do this operation? In binary, how can you do it? If you want to build a logic which is going to do this, how will you do it? If I wanted to write a program of 3 lines which is going to perform the operation and measure the distance, the Hamming distance between those two code words, what should you do?
If W1 equal W2.
Hmm?
Zero.
Okay.
If W1 equal
W2. No, equal that or equal. So we should equalize the distance in the middle. Tell me?
Zero.
Huh? XOR the first one with the second one, right? What will you get? You will get ones only at the different locations, right? And the remaining ones, zeros. After you do the XOR, what should you do? Sum the values of the bits. That's good. So basically, if you want to calculate this Hamming distance between W1, it's equal to W1 XORed with W2, and then you sum over all bits, right? So after performing the XOR here, you will end up with what? La, just the XOR. After performing the XOR, you will end up with what? 1 0 0 0 1 1 0 0 0 1. صح? Correct? This is when you do the XOR between the two. Correct ولا لا? Okay, and then you sum the values. What will you get? 1 + 0 + 0 + 0 + 1 + 1 + 0 + 1. What will you get? 4. Okay. So the XOR is a binary operation, but the summation here is a decimal operation. It's not a binary summation. Okay. So this is called the distance between any two code words. So two important things that we have learned, okay, in addition to the concept of why adding redundancy allows me to have better reliability in communication. Okay? The two concepts are that the valid transmission combination of bits is called code word. Okay? And the second thing is that the distance between any two code words is equal to the number of bits, bit locations, where they have different bit values, okay? Now, after having this, like, floor, okay, I'm going to tell you two things. Number one, that these are the two techniques that we are going to study, and these are the two techniques that are applied in the data link control for error detection. I'm not going to talk now at error correction, just for error detection, in order to figure out that this received data has an error. Okay? The two techniques are parity check or cyclic redundancy. Both techniques are dependent on adding. So they both, more or less, from a conceptual point of view, do the same thing. Adding extra
bits.
Redundant, yes, exactly. Bits. Right? To information. Right? Where the bits, the redundant bits, are a function of the information, right? Okay? But the way the function is calculated is different between parity and redundant and cyclic redundancy check. So both of them have, you have information bits, B1, B2, B3, whatever, right? And then you add to that, to these information bits, extra redundant bits. But how you calculate the redundant bits based on the information bits is different. For the parity, there is one way of calculation, which is a little bit simpler. For the cyclic redundancy, there is a different way of calculation. Why? Why do we have two ways of doing it? Each one of them has different properties, different application, different performance. Okay? So if this is the case, this moment must be a natural moment where I tell you how you can actually evaluate any error detection technique. What parameters that you use to evaluate an error detection technique? These three parameters that you see in front of you are the parameters that are used to evaluate an error detection technique, okay? The first one is called the minimum distance of the code, okay? Now, in the previous slide, I've taught you about how to calculate the distance, okay? So when I ask for the minimum distance, what do you think you have to do?
Find the distance between each code word and the other, and take the minimum.
Exactly. So basically, the minimum distance is simply, how do you find this? It is the distance between every pair of code words in the code and pick the smallest, right? So if my code word has W1, W2, W3, right, as valid code words, for example. Assume that I have a code word, or let's make it 4, okay? So in this case, to calculate the minimum distance, I need to calculate the distance between W1, W2, right? And the distance between W1, W3. The distance between W1, W4, okay? Distance between W2, W3, and so on, right? And then out of all these pairs of distances, I will pick the minimum one. That one is the property of my code, which is called the minimum distance of the code. Okay? Clear to everyone? Can I ask you a question? Please. Why is it? Why is it?
What's your new question? So here you have 2 to the power 4, so equals 16, 16 point, that's right?
No.
Yes. Because you can say
no, here. This is not 2 to the power 4. From 4, but you have a lot of repeated. You don't have to take D1, D1.
The same.
Combinations.
Not combinations or permutations?
No,
combinations.
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 Yani, tlau kem?
Yani, 42.
Hmm? 42 اللي هتطلع كام؟
4 فاكتوريال 24 I think.
هم؟ يا راجل 4 في 3 على؟ 4 على فاكتوريال كام؟ انت بتقول 4C2 صح؟ 4 في 3 على كام؟ على 2 4 في 3 ب 12 على 2 6 تمام؟ هم هيطلعوا 6 اوكي؟ سو اني ويز يعني عدد الكالكوليشنز اللي محتاج تعملهم هنا هم 6
find the minimum distance.
But there are smarter ways to find the minimum distance of a code, but it's not our issue now, okay? That has to do with code analysis, we're not gonna do that, okay? So that's one property, okay? What does the minimum distance have as a value to represent how good a code is? Of course, from an abstract point of view, it tells me how far the points are, tamam? Which means it's a good measure of error resilience, okay? But then I want to map this to actual error resilience. So simply, let me describe to you the statement that we have here, or if someone can describe it, I prefer that. It says that if you are at D, which is the minimum distance, okay, errors occur, they will always be detected. Why? Can you explain this from the geometry that I showed you? Can you explain this from the geometry that I showed to you in the previous slide?
Yes.
If you cannot, minus one. If you can, plus one.
Because, as you said, that the
distance... 0%. عشان minus one جاية في السكة.
The distance between each point will be large, and as you said, that you can't see it clearly. So the detection for the error before it comes, it will be... you can't detect the error before...
انا عايز انت اللي انت بتقوله ده كده يعني كلام حلو قوي بس has nothing to do with what I asked. I said why is it that if you have an error that occurs in number of bits fewer than the minimum distance this error will always be detectable. ليه اللي انت جاوبت عليه ده مش اجابة على السؤال ده بس انا مش هنقصك.
Because we have the minimum. D is the minimum distance.
Okay.
So if it is less for so because for each another code word, the distance will be larger than it.
Yeah, if it's less, it's an error. If it's greater, it's an error as well.
But in some case, I have the minimum distance. So, like one of these six have a larger distance. But if the distance is fewer than each this one, so I have an error. Exactly, I have an error.
يعني
it should be an
error. انت كده تلتين الإجابة. انت كده التلتين الاجابه فاضل حته عشان تشرح بس اشرح بالعربي ذاتس فاين خليه يكمل يا اخي كلامه يا اخي اصبر عليه
دي اقصر مسافه بين السته الموجودين
مش هديله واحد بس ما تقعدوش تكبسه عليه كده
يعني انا اذا جت عندي مسافه اقل من مسافه السته الموجودين
كويس
اكيد لو رحت اكون معروف هعرف ان في
ايرور هعرف ان في ايرور ليه؟
لان كل المسافات الباقيه هتكون اكبر
برضه فاضل مش بقول لك انا فاضل تلت كده انت ما جبتوش ممكن نرسمها بس ها
the geometric boundaries as a so we have boundaries and each boundary has a distance so if
تعال ارسمها
distance is
large تعال ارسمها تعال ارسمها so now this was the first parameter the minimum distance I'll come back to your question after this okay the second parameter is the burst detection ability okay now errors can happen in two different modes if I'm sending a set of bits b1 B2, B3, up to BK. Okay? These are information bits. Tamam? Errors can happen in a scattered manner. So for example, this guy has an error, this guy has an error, and maybe this guy. Okay? That's called a scattered error or single bit errors. Tamam? Non-consecutive bit errors. Okay? The other option is B1, B2, B3, up to BK. And then, for example, from B2 up to B6, they are all in error. Okay? That's what the channel does. It actually takes a block of consecutive bits and it destroys them. Okay? This is called an error burst. Okay? Or burst error. Tamam? This type of error, if you study further into coding theory that has to do with designing channel coding techniques and error detection techniques, these are more difficult to detect when they happen in consecutive bits. They are more difficult to detect. Okay? Mathematically, why? It's out of the scope of this course. It's out of the scope of an undergrad course. Okay? But there is a mathematical reason why this is more difficult to detect. Okay? Now, when you design a particular code, they typically have a certain limit on, number one, the number of bits in error that they can detect. In general, so for example, they can detect non-consecutive 6, 10, 11 bit errors. Tamam? And you will find that the same code can only detect, for example, 3 burst bit errors only. Okay?
while another one, another better design, can detect 5 bursts and so on. Okay? So it's not enough to say that your code is able to detect a certain number of bit errors. You have to also specify how many in bursts it can detect. Okay? And typically these two numbers are different. Plus, any questions about this? Yes.
Okay, question, right?
Yeah, you think question.
If we have something like burst error, then the possibility of having more, yani, a distance, the Hamming distance is more than the minimum, and thus we will not be able to detect it with the normal.
Okay,
so the way we describe the previous slide, the next slide, it's only valid if we have only one bit error.
If you have anything smaller than the minimum distance, healthy, you will always be able to detect burst detection. Okay? If you have anything greater than the minimum distance, then you start discussing. If you have greater than the minimum distance, can be detected. And your ability to detect errors that are greater than the minimum distance, which are scattered, is typically higher than detecting errors greater than the minimum distance, which are in the burst.
Yes.
Okay? That's that is to simplify or summarize. Yes, I think.
كويس اوكي لا ما خلاص بقى 75 كان زمان last parameter that you use to measure the performance of your error detection code is something called the probability of random bit pattern تمام being detected as a valid code word. تعالوا نبص how to calculate this probability. اوكي if I have a set of B1, B2, up to BK, okay? And then adding to those parities, P1, P2, up to PR, okay? How many total number of bits I have here?
K plus R.
I هي نفس الحاجة بس أنا حسيتها لوجيكال أكثر K plus R فاستنيت لما حد يقولها K plus R. Okay? So anyway, it's K plus R bits. مظبوط؟ Okay. The question is, if this bit pattern is set in random, يعني كده أي حاجة, how many possibilities are there?
Random.
How many possibilities لو هختار الفاليو بتاعتهم random؟ عندي كام possibility to choose these? Infinity
K, possibilities.
How many possibilities? عندي K plus R bits. How many possibilities?
K plus
R. 1 over K. K
possibilities.
K possibilities.
2
over
K plus R.
أيوة.
1 over 2 K plus
R.
ما فيش 1. ما فيش 1 over 2 لسه. أنا بقول عندي كام. ما قلتش probability بتاعت أي واحدة. بقول how many.
2 power.
Okay, 2 power.
So it's 2 to the power K plus R. صح؟ So if I'm going to set these randomly without really being careful to choose the parity such that they are a function of the others and so on, يبقى possibility is موجودة عندي 2 to the power
K
plus R. Now how many valid code words are there هنا?
2K. 2 power K.
2 to the power?
2 to the power K.
K. Yeah. صح? لأن عندي K bits only for data, صح?
Yes.
And when you take the number of valid code words, you look at the information bits. مظبوط? طيب. يبقى the possibility of a code, a random code being detected as a valid code word يطلع كام؟ The probability بقى. بص اقرأ وفكر قبل ما تجاوب. خلاص؟ The possibility of a random code being detected as a valid code word يطلع كام؟ عندي كام random code؟ 2 to the power K plus R. عندي كام valid code؟
2
to the power K. What's the possibility of a random code being a valid code?
1 over 2 power. Possibility of valid code over the
بالزبط. Number of valid code over the total number of possible random values. صح؟ يبقى this probability that we are looking for, the probability of random bit pattern mistaken as error free, يعني معناها as being valid code words, تمام؟ هي عبارة عن 2 to the power K divided by 2 to the power K plus R. Which is equal to
2 to the power minus
2 to the power minus 1, which shows you that as you add more redundant bits, لأن الـ R the number of redundant bits, تمام؟ As you add more redundant bits, you get better value for this probability, لأنها the smaller the better, صح؟ بالمعنى كده the possibility إن حاجة random دي كده تبقى valid becomes less and less. ليه؟ عمال تكبر في السبيس وتثبت عدد الكود وورد، صح؟ فكل ما تكبر السبيس وتثبت عدد الكود وورد، البروبابيلتي بتاعت كل واحدة فيهم أقل، مظبوط؟ Being random selected becomes less, تمام؟
هو ده أنا
قلته. آه. طيب كويس. هاي هو ده السؤال اللي كنت هتسأله؟ هو ده اللي انت اقترحته في الأول؟
في الأول خالص.
اوكي جود. Any questions? So what we did today, we did not yet discuss the techniques which are the two techniques اللي هم الباريتي والCRC. They should be simple, but I wanted to flourish the floor so that you know exactly what are the parameters, what are we doing, why actually adding redundant bits, how does it look like, what's the benefit, what are the measures of your performance. So we have discussed all these points. Any questions before I let you go? حتى thank you أسرع واحد فيها يا عم استنى ادي فرصة يمكن في حد هيسأل خلاص. اوكي thank you. Who wrote يعني انا بقالي مرتين في ناس انا عايز حد يرسمها. لا 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 اهو ادي الكيوب. This is the cube. تعال انت لو عايز تكمل اجابتك ارسمها. This is the cube right that we had in the previous slide. مظبوط. تمام. Where were the valid points؟ ادي one point. ادي the other point. Okay. This is the third point and this was the fourth point. مظبوط. These were our valid points. تمام. Now the question says if an error happens in number of bits which is smaller than the minimum distance. So I ask you, if you put the minimum distance here,
square root of minimum distance.
How many bits are different between any code word and the other?
Two.
So the Hamming distance here between any two code words is two. You can minimum distance can
two.
Two. مظبوط. طيب. احنا بنقول بقى انه لو حصل error اقل من minimum distance بمعنى انه ممكن يحصل error في كام بيت؟
One
bit. It will be detected. ليه detected?
It will be in the same
size. We have
the...
خليه هو الإجابة.
We have less than distance. So it's not two, so it's only one.
Okay.
So we have this point. So we are here or here or here.
Okay.
But we know possible combinations. So from the bit, from first bit, we know any which pair we are. From the other bit, we know we are not here.
بمعنى صح. كويس بس مش هتاخد الواحد لان هو جاوب شويه وانت جاوبت شويه فخلاص بقى وانا رسمت الرسمه فخلاص فهارد لك يعني. بمعنى اصح as simple as the transmitter is going to always send one of these. صح ده الترانسميتر مظبوط. تمام. An error happens in the medium. This error is causing one bit to change. تمام. Let's assume ان الترانسميتر بعد دي لو one bit بس هي اللي اتغيرت, what's the receiver gonna see? ايه البوسيبيليتيز للريسيفر؟ ايه هما؟ يا هنا يا هنا يا هنا. صح. These are the ones that are one bit away from the transmitted one. Is any one of these a valid code word? يبقى معنى كده هيوصل لي في الريسيفر invalid فاقدر اديتكت انه حصل ايرور. تمام. However لو two bits happens, تمام, كان ممكن الترانسميتر يبعت دي والريسيفر يستقبل دي. حصل ايرور but can I detect that error? No, because I received a valid code word. So I don't know that an error happened. تمام. But this is why if the number of errors happens in bits less than the minimum distance, it's detectable because you will always land on an invalid code word in the plane. خلاص. Yes.
I think this is only possible if the minimum distance is even. Like if the minimum distance is odd, we can also jump to another possible
minimum distance. Think of it this way. To move from one of these to the other, you have to move the minimum distance or more. صح. But the error is moving you less. يعني معناها توقف في حتة تانية.
تحطوها على واحدة أي واحدة من التانيين تمام؟ يس
قلت له بس still we have a problem if two bit how can we fix this issue؟
That's a different story يعني حكاية how can we fix this issue؟ You have to use a different coding scheme. That different coding scheme is gonna have errors in other situations. اللي احنا اتفقنا من الأول إنك cannot eliminate all errors صح؟ فأنت ممكن تحسن performance بإنك تستخدم سكيم مختلف غير parity scheme تمام؟ لكن you will never reach a point where all errors are detected مش بس ده اللي قلته في أول الليكتشر خلاص؟ okay. Anyone has any other questions?
Yes. If the transmitter transmitted another one and an error happened there and that symbol or whatever. So the three.
يعني إيه يعني إيه the transmitter transmitted another one.
Another one there.
Another valid.
Another valid. Yeah.
Okay. وبعدين.
An error happened in that transmission.
يعني إيه an error happened with that transmission.
Less than D. I mean, an error happened with less than D.
ماشي.
So the possibilities might have like same possibilities, but one like. What I mean is the possibilities of the error will be the same. So how can we detect which one is transmitted?
Detect which one is transmitted معناه انك تقدر تكوركت الايرور انا ما قلتش ان انا بكوركت بنتكلم على detecting that an error occurred تمام لكن figuring out which one was transmitted means I was able to actually correct the error that's a different story خلاص انا بس هنا على detection okay valid question but early. We will move to that later any other questions yes
here for every
سؤال كمان وهتاخده 75 ريال ها
We added
an extra parity bit. Okay. So here we have an inefficiency of 50%. Yes.
With the increase of number of bits, with this efficiency increase, like we don't lose
50% of the bandwidth. We don't. Like, increase increase of number of which bits, information bits, while increase number of parity bits in a specific rate. With this rate, yield higher efficiency. It's up to your design. كده absolutely you need a certain number of parity. There is nothing that says this. What's said is for a particular number of information bits and a particular performance that you need to meet, you need this amount, right? Then on the other side comes the story of but I'm losing efficiency. So there is a trade-off. تمام? So as a designer or as an engineer, you have to pick some value for the parities that achieves what you are aiming for without wasting too much resources as much as possible, تمام? There is a trade-off in the story. Any other questions? Yeah, نفدتم الخمسة وسبعين ريال. خلاص.